topic of traffic control devices, and we said there are three types of traffic control devices: signs, signals, and markings. Okay, we discussed two of them, and today we will continue the discussion about traffic signals, and we will do it in more details in the coming classes as well. Okay, so we said yesterday there are nine types of traffic signals. Okay, there are some conditions or some restrictions when you are trying to install a signal. The first one is, once you install a signal, it cannot be switched off. Once you install a signal, it cannot be switched off. Okay, because it will create confusion for the drivers. If the signal is operational at some time and then at some other time it is switched off, it will create confusion for the driver. Secondly, you cannot use a stop sign with a signal. There's a signal, there cannot be a stop sign. Again, the same point of confusion. The signal is showing green, there's a stop sign there, what should the driver do? Okay. So we cannot use a stop sign with a signal as well. Now, if for any condition you feel the signal should be switched off, or you feel that I should not use a signal, like maybe I can just use a stop sign at this particular time of the day, using a stop sign is better. Instead of putting a stop sign or instead of switching off the signal, you can operate the signal in flashing yellow or flashing red mode. Okay, so the signal will keep on flashing yellow light or it will keep on flashing red light. So instead of switching off the signal or putting a stop sign on the signal, this is much better and this is also allowed. Okay, so flashing yellow means you will proceed through the intersection like it's a give way or yield sign. So flashing yellow is equal to a give way or yield sign. So you do the same thing, come to the intersection slowly, nobody on the other side, keep on moving, otherwise stop. Okay, and flashing red is like a stop sign. So you come to the intersection, you stop, signal is flashing red, you stop, and you proceed when the signal is when the intersection is empty. Okay, so these are allowed. Okay, and I'm not talking about flashing green. Flashing green is part of the signal. Okay, after flashing green it will turn to yellow and then it will turn red and so on. So I'm not talking about flashing green. Okay, this is flashing green is part of the operation, normal operation of the signal. Okay, what are the benefits of installing a signal? When you install a signal, you are forcing the vehicles to stop on the red light. You are forcing them. This red light may be for 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 60 seconds. So you are forcing them, you are creating delay for them, you are stopping them. So there must be some benefits of it, right? Otherwise, why are we doing it? So some of the benefits are listed here. Signals can increase the capacity of the critical movements of the intersection. Critical movements meaning the movements which have high volume. Okay, critical movements mean movement which have high volume. For those movements, if you provide a signal, it is because then the drivers can move at high speed and simultaneously. Without a signal, what happens? Vehicles move one by one, right? One driver moves and then the other driver has to decide, should I move with him or should I wait? So this takes extra amount of time from the from the driver, right? So every time a new driver is deciding to enter, he is taking some time. He is delaying himself and the others. But if the same driver sees I have a green signal, he will not think about whether I should go or not. So he will go faster. Other drivers will go with him as well. So the flow will be more capacity, more speed. Okay, with a signal. Without a signal, they will take time to decide. Some of them will be confused. They will not move simultaneously and less flow, less speed. Okay. With a signal, you can reduce the frequency of severe accidents which can happen at right angle, pedestrian accident, turning accidents, because these accidents normally happen because of the confusion of the driver. Two drivers entered the intersection at the same time, or when the pedestrians were crossing, and they resulted in they get into an accident. But with a signal, there's very little chance that two drivers or one driver and a crossing pedestrian will be meeting at any point, will be colliding at any point, because they have different timings, right? So they will move in different times. Signals can provide for continuous movement through the intersections. If you have a series of intersections, if you have a main highway, that are the series of intersections, and these intersections are very close to each other. Then you can do the programming or designing of the signal in such a way that the vehicles move through the series without stopping, move through the series of intersection without stopping. So when the vehicles reach from intersection 1 to intersection 2, signal is green. When they reach intersection 3, it is still green. Like the signal at that intersection is green and they keep on moving. Okay. So with the signal, coordination is possible, right? You are designing the time, so you can design it accordingly. Signal also interrupts the heavy movement, the movement which has more volume, the major road, to allow sufficient time for the minor road and the pedestrians as well. Okay. Sometimes without a signal, you have a stop sign or a roundabout, the vehicles keep on coming from the major road. So the vehicles on the minor road or the pedestrians don't have the chance, they don't get even half a second to enter the intersection. Obviously, they will not enter in half a second. Okay, it's dangerous. But I'm just giving you the idea. So they don't have any time. There is a series, there's a line of vehicles which keep on coming from the major road without stopping. So the guys on the minor road, pedestrians or vehicles, don't get the chance to enter the intersection. With the signal, they have their proper chance, right? With the signal, the major road will be closed at some time, it will be stopped at some time, and the drivers on the minor road will have their chance. Drivers of the pedestrians. Now let us talk about signal indications. And we call them signal lights, right? We call them signal lights. Green light, red light. In the book, they have mentioned them as balls. Okay, so ball, light means the same thing. Green ball, yellow ball, red ball, flashing ball, arrow indication. So why we call them ball? Because they are circular, right? They are circular. And if you take out one light of the signal, it is completely circle, like a ball, football. Okay, much heavier, believe me, much heavier. Okay, so green ball means it will allow movement through the intersection, right? Yellow ball means you pass with caution. It's a change between the green and red. Okay, so we also call it the change interval as well. Okay, and red ball means whoever is facing that signal with a green indication, pedestrians or vehicles, they have to stop. And the stopping should be before the crosswalk or before the stop line or before the conflict point, wherever it is safe. Okay. Then we have flashing ball or flashing green. I've already mentioned in the previous slide. So flashing means that signal is flashing yellow or flashing red. As I said, flashing green is considered part of green. It's an indication to the driver that signal is about to turn green. It's not something special. Flashing red, flashing yellow, it is continuously flashing. All other indications are closed. So flashing yellow means what? Only yellow is flashing. Okay, it will not turn to red or green after that. It will keep on flashing yellow. Same thing with flashing red as well. So we are talking about continuous flashing, and that is only allowed for red or yellow. And I already told you, yellow means like a giveaway, and red means like a stop sign. Then we have arrow indications. So you must have seen it on major highways. Sheikh Salman Highway, Sheikh Zayed Highway, 16 December Highway, Sheikh Isa bin Salman Highway. The signals on these highways have separate signals for turning, right? So these signals, inside the ball of the signal, you will see the arrow, right? Inside the light of the signal, you will see the arrow. So if the signal is the arrow, that means this signal, this particular light, is for this movement only. Without the arrow, it means that it is for all the movements from that approach. So you will find it on many minor roads. You will find this type without arrow. Without arrow means what? Everybody who is looking at that, who is coming from that approach, can move when the signal is green for them. Okay. But arrow means it is for a specific movement. Okay, these are the sight distances for signals. Okay, and they are calculated using the 85th percentile speed. So 85th percentile, I've explained the concepts about percentile and 85th percentile speed and plot speed. So 85th percentile means that it is the maximum speed for 85% drivers. And for finding out 85th percentile speed, you have to draw a cumulative frequency curve. We have drawn it in spot speed chapter. And I told you 85th percentile speed is considered as the upper limit for reasonable drivers, for reasonable, sane, good drivers. Okay. signal components, some more terminologies related to the signal cycle. So a signal cycle is the process in which signal completes all its indications. The process in which signal completes all its indications. Okay, so in other words, all movements complete their green time. All movements will complete their green time. Okay, so red, yellow, green for, you know, all the movements. That is one cycle. Cycle length is the time taken to complete a cycle. How much time is taken to complete a cycle? And it is represented with capital letter C. Then we have interval. Interval is part of the signal cycle. That part when the indications are constant. When the indications are constant. So for example, you have green light. Okay, so the time for which the green light remains is one interval. Then the green will change to yellow. This is another interval. And the time for which the signal remains yellow is the interval. Okay. When the yellow changes to red, that is the next interval. And it will remain that interval until some other signal changes. Okay. Then we have different types of intervals. We have change interval, which I told you, yellow time. And it is represented with a small y. We have all red interval, which is also known as clearance interval. Clearance or all red interval, represented with AR. Now what is that? Some drivers enter the intersection when the signal is yellow. They are allowed to enter, right? But do you know how much time the signal will remain yellow? No, nobody knows. From the time I've entered the intersection, I don't know for how many seconds it will remain yellow. So you entered the intersection. Okay, you judged, okay, I have enough time to cross an intersection. Signal was yellow when you entered. Okay. When you are in the intersection, the signal has become red behind you. You didn't know. You need some more time to cross the intersection. So now before any other movement starts, all signal will remain red. Okay. So the signal for the next movement is also red. And the signal for the previous movement is also red. So all movements are red. So we call it all red. And why we give this time? Because we want to allow the driver to pass through the intersection. The driver to clear the intersection. Which driver? The driver who has already entered the intersection. Okay, the driver who has already entered the intersection during yellow. Okay. Then we have the green interval, the red interval. You know what it means. Then we have the phase. Phase is the complete time given for one movement or set of movements happening together. Phase is the complete time given for one movement or set of movements which are happening together. So we have like straight and left, they're happening together. So this is the time for both these movements. Phase time includes green, yellow, and all red interval. Green, yellow, and all red interval. Green, change interval or clearance interval. Right. We can also say it in these terms, green plus change interval plus clearance interval. Okay. So this is the phase time and this is the time when movement is allowed. At the end of this time, this movement will be blocked. Okay, and some other movement will start to appear. Okay, some other movement will start to receive the green. Signal can be operated in three ways, pre-timed, semi-actuated, fully actuated. Pre-time means that you have you predict the traffic volume in different times of the day. Then according to your prediction, you design the signal timings. Okay, how much should be the cycle length, green time, yellow time, and okay, all the intervals you design according to your prediction. Now you know, as a traffic engineer, we know that at different times of the day, traffic changes. So we prepare we predict traffic for different times of the day. And we prepare signal timing plans according to our prediction. So in a pre-time signal, we have different timing plans, which are for different times of the day. Okay, so we have an internal clock within the controller of the signal, and we program the signal to adopt a particular timing according to the time in the clock. For example, you say AM peak hour is from 7 to 9 for AM peak hour. Adopt this timing. PM peak hour is from 4 to 6 p.m. And in PM peak hour, I have a different directions having more volume. So this will be the plan and so on. Okay. But the main point here is in pre-timed operation, you are depending upon your prediction and not the actual traffic, not the actual traffic. Then we have semi-actuated. Actuated signals or actuated operation means the signal is connected with a detector or sensor on the road. Okay, the signal is connected with a detector or sensor on the road. Then we will call it an actuated signal. The signal can be semi-actuated or fully actuated. Semi-actuated means that it is connected between, semi-actuated is used where we have major road crossing a minor road. Major road crossing a minor road. So we put detectors or sensors on the minor road. There are detectors and sensors on the minor road. So what happens? Signal remains green for the major road until a car appears on the minor road and it will pass through the detector. From the detector, the signal will have the call, or the signal will have the indication that now I must turn green for the minor road as well. The major road should be blocked, minor road should be open. Okay. Until that happens, the major road will keep on having green. Until a car comes on minor road, the signal will keep on having green. So if you want to see semi-accurate signals, the new signals on that highway, the one which is in front of the traffic school, the new signal which they have installed there, that is semi-actuated. So until somebody comes from the street, their side street there, the signal for the main street remains green. Okay. Then we have fully actuated. Fully actuated is applied when you have two major roads crossing each other. So you have a detector or sensor on all the approaches of the road, all approaches, 3, 4, whatever. And all signal timings will be changed according to the data coming from the detector or sensor. Okay. So the green time can change, cycle length can change, even the sequence of phase can change. Okay. So normally you will see that, okay, after the east side, the west side will have the green. After the west, the north side will have the green. Then after north, the south side will have the green. So you have some sort of an order. Okay. In which order the approaches will receive the green. In a fully actuated signal, this order can also change. Okay, so now the order is after north, it should be east. But in the next cycle, after north, it can be the west as well, because there are more vehicles on the west side. Okay, so depending upon traffic, you can change the order of the phase as well. Okay, so fully actuated signal, everything can change. Cycle length can change. Okay. Green time can change, phasing sequence can change. Okay, so minute to minute operation of the signal is changing according to traffic volume. Okay, so whatever is required by the volume, you change the signal time according to that. Not you, like the signal is doing it itself. You program it, the signal is doing it itself. In actuated signals, you have to give ranges to the signal. The signal will work within the ranges. Okay, so you give the range of cycle length. You give the range for green time. So a signal can change the green time or the cycle length according to volume, but within the range. Let's say the range is from 100 to 300 seconds. So the minimum cycle length is 100, maximum 300. The signal will change within these two values according to the traffic volume. It will not go over 300, it will not go below 100 as well, in any case. Okay, so in actuated signals, your work is increased. When you are programming the signal, you have to give a range for each timing. Okay, so there's a signal can change it within the range. Then we have talked about signal coordination earlier, right? Signal coordination is applied on major highways, arterials. Okay, let me show you a video. Some of you were saying I don't show videos, so here you are. But this is about signal coordination, okay? So it's a long video, but I'm just showing the part about signal coordination.
Act on other components in the system. Take the classic example of two signals closely spaced in a row on a major roadway. If one signal gives a green but the next one doesn't, cars can back up. If they back up far enough, they can sit through multiple cycles at an intersection without being able to pass through until the light beyond clears. It's a frustrating experience for anyone. A signal is inadvertently but significantly reducing the capacity of an adjacent signal. The solution to this problem is signal coordination, where lights can not only consider the traffic waiting at their intersection, but also the status of nearby signals. This is a very common configuration on long corridors with relatively minor but frequent cross streets. The signals on a major road are timed so that a large group of vehicles, called a platoon by traffic engineers, can make it all the way through the corridor without interruption. This type of signal coordination can significantly increase the volume of traffic that can pass through intersections, but it only works on stretches of road that don't have other sources of traffic interruptions, like driveways and businesses. If the platoon can't stick together, the benefits of coordinating signals...
Okay, so... this was a brief video about signal coordination. Okay, so signal coordination, like I said earlier, you program a series of signals so that when the vehicles reach from one intersection to the adjacent one, they find the signal green and they can keep on moving. It's applied on major roads which have close intersections, closely spaced cross streets. Wherever the cross street is coming, they have an intersection. Okay, so it keeps the vehicles moving. The parameter which we use for coordinating the signal, connecting the signal timing from one to the other intersection, is known as offset. Okay, so what is an offset? It is the parameter which is connecting the green time of one signal to the other signal. Okay, or the difference of green time of one signal to the adjacent signal. So it depends upon how much time the vehicle needs to go from intersection one to intersection two and so on. So each signal is programmed in connection with the offset from the previous intersection. Okay, there is one restriction in signal coordination, that all signals which are coordinated must have the same cycle length. All signals which are coordinated must have the same cycle length. Without same cycle length, the offsets will not work. The offsets will not work. Okay, so this is a restriction. The examples of coordinated signals in Bahrain, Umm Nasan Highway, 16 December Highway. Okay, some of the signals, Umm Nasan especially, signals are coordinated. Okay, 16 December, I think one or two are coordinated. Okay, two more important terms about signals: saturation headway and saturation flow rate. So, first of all, saturation headway. We have already defined headway is the time interval between two vehicles when they are passing a point. Okay, the time difference between two vehicles when they are passing a point. So saturation headway is the minimum headway achieved by the vehicles in the queue when they are passing through the intersection. The minimum headway achieved by the vehicles in the queue when they are passing through the intersection. And this minimum headway is achieved when the flow is saturated and stable. When the flow is saturated and stable. Saturated means it is up to the capacity, and stable means it is continuously moving without stopping. There is no stopping. Okay, so it's not like two vehicles move, then stop, then another two move, then stop. Okay, it's not like this. Then you cannot achieve saturation headway in that case. So we are talking about continuous flow of traffic from the queue, from the intersection, continuous stable flow of traffic, okay, without any stoppage. So this saturation headway is indicated or is referred to with small h. Okay. Now we have studied the relationship between headway and flow rate in lecture number three actually. So they are inverse of each other, right? Headway is inverse of flow rate. So you can see the equation on the slide as well at the bottom. Okay. H is the saturation headway. Now if you are using saturation headway to calculate the flow rate, then the flow rate will be known as saturation flow rate. Okay, this is a general relationship. You can use any value of the headway to calculate the corresponding flow rate. But if you are using the saturation headway to calculate the flow rate, then the flow rate will be known as saturation flow rate. Okay, so you can see instead of using V, which we normally use for the flow rate, they are using S here. Okay, so S means saturation flow rate and H is saturation headway. So S is inverse of H. The relationship is very simple. What is this 3600 here? Can someone tell me? What is this 3600 doing in the equation? It's a very simple question.
Convert the units?
Yes. Headway is in seconds, the flow rate will be in weakest per hour, right? Weakest per hour. Now, so flow rate is in weakest per hour. That means the weakers are moving for 1 hour on the signal. It's not possible, right? On a signal, weakers cannot have a stable continuous flow for 1 hour. Signal turns into yellow and then red. Okay, so the headway will not remain constant during these times, and the red time, the flow will be zero. Okay, so saturation flow rate is an ideal value, a theoretical value. Saturation flow rate is an ideal or theoretical value. Okay, it can happen when you have 1 hour of green, which is not possible. Weakest per hour, right? So if you have 1 hour of green, then the weakest will keep on moving for 1 hour, and then you can achieve saturation flow rate. But obviously, no signal will have 1 hour of green. So saturation headway or saturation, saturation flow rate. Sorry, saturation flow rate is a ideal value or theoretical value which can only be achieved when you have 1 hour of green. That is not possible. Okay. To clarify the concept of saturation headway. So for example, you have, let's say, n vehicles in the queue. N vehicle. Number of vehicles in the queue is n. When the signal turns green, the first driver who will pass the stop line will need some time for preparation, right? He sees the signal turning green and he will, you know, put the phone away, change the gear, okay, put the glasses on, whatever. So he will take some time to prepare, and then when he will cross the stop line, his speed will be slower. He is the first guy in the queue, right? So he is the slowest reaching the stop line, okay? The guy behind him had more time to prepare, and he had more distance to the stop line as well. So his speed will be higher. The third guy, even more time to prepare, even higher speed. So when you keep on observing more vehicles or the subsequent vehicles in the queue, their headways keep on increasing because of these factors. Subsequent drivers in the queue, the drivers who are at the back of the queue, they had more time to prepare because they have already seen cars moving in front of them. And when they reached the stop line, their speed was also higher. So their headway was less. Their headway was smaller, okay, as compared to the first two, three vehicles. So the trend of headway follows this curve. Okay, so for the first pair of vehicles, the headway is the highest, then it keeps on decreasing until you reach the fourth or the fifth vehicle in the queue. At the fourth or the fifth vehicle in the queue, the headway attains the minimum value, and then it remains approximately the same value. Okay, so the saturation headway is achieved from the fourth or the fifth vehicle in the queue. The first three, four vehicles take more headway. The headway between the first three, four vehicles is higher than the headway of the remaining vehicle. Okay, so the minimum headway, the saturation headway, is achieved when you reach the fourth or the fifth vehicle in the queue. Okay, and the extra headway taken by the first three board vehicles, extra compared to the saturation value. So let's say your saturation value was 3 seconds. Okay, so you take the difference of this headway with the headway of the first three, four vehicles. Okay, so whatever the difference comes, we will call it delta. Okay, so delta is the difference between the initial few vehicles in the queue and the saturation value. So for example, for the first two vehicles, the headway was 4 seconds, saturation is 3 seconds, so delta will be 1 second. For the next two vehicles, headway was 3.5, saturation is 3, difference will be 0.5, delta will be 0.5. So you calculate delta for the first three, four vehicles in the queue, and then you add it together. So delta for all the vehicles which had the extra headway, you add the delta for all of them, and that will be called as a startup loss time, L1. Okay, so L1 is a summation of extra headway caused in addition to the saturation headway by the first three, four vehicles in the queue. Startup loss time is the extra headway caused in comparison to the saturation headway by the first three, four vehicles in the queue, L1. So you take the difference with the saturation value and you add all the differences will give you L1. So every time the signal turns green, you will have some startup lost time or L1. In one phase, we have two types of lost times: startup lost time, clearance lost time. We already talked about startup lost time, L1. Then we have clearance lost time as well. What is clearance lost time? L2. This is connected with the all red time. This is connected with the all red time. If you remember, I told you, all red time is given for the driver to clear the intersection, right? So it is not like the driver needs 1 second of to clear the intersection, and we are only giving 1 second of all red time. No, we keep some margin of safety. We keep some margin of safety. So in that time, so clearance lost time is part of all red time. When the driver has already cleared the intersection, but still you are keeping some margin of safety before the next approach receives the green. Okay. So in that time, in that margin of safety time, no vehicle is entering the intersection, right? No vehicle is moving into the intersection. This is startup lost time. Startup lost time. So startup lost time basically part of all red time, which you have kept for as a safety measure. Okay. So in a phase, we have two types of lost time: L1, L2, startup lost time and clearance lost time. You add them together, you get TL. TL is a total lost time per phase. Total lost time in each phase of the signal. Okay, then we have the concept of effective green. Effective green is a time during which the vehicles are moving at saturation headway. The vehicles are moving at saturation headway. That is effective green. So there is an actual green time and there is an effective green time. Okay, what is the difference between them? Actual green time is when the signal was showing you the green light. That is actual green. And then we have the effective green time when the vehicles pass through the intersection at saturation headway. Okay. So in this case, obviously, we have already said the first 3-4 vehicles are not part of it then, right? The first 3-4 vehicles which are in the startup lost time are not part of it. Okay. And then again, in the end, you have the clearance lost time. In the clearance lost time, nobody is moving. So that is also deducted. That is also subtracted from the green time. Okay. So effective green time equals, you can see the equation on the slide here. Effective green time equals capital G, which is the actual green time, okay, plus capital Y. Capital Y is yellow plus all red. Capital Y is yellow plus all red. So green plus yellow plus all red minus total lost time. Total lost time including startup as well as clearance. Startup lost time as well as clearance lost. Okay. So if somebody says, give me the green time, effective green time, you take the signal timings, you find out the lost time, and then you can calculate the effective mean time in this manner. Okay, now we have a problem which I will start tomorrow, inshallah. Okay. So if you have any questions, you can ask me. And please do the evaluation. Okay, please do the evaluation. Okay, it's important. Okay, Hissa Ahmad Ali Khalil and Qusay Ahmad. Hissa Ahmad Ali Khalil and Qusay Ahmad.